see you.
Thanks for having me on.
It's an absolute pleasure to have you on, and congratulations. The film is superb.
Oh, good. You saw it and liked it.
I really loved it. I go to Sweeney's quite a lot, and it was packed, and everyone loved it.
Oh, it's good. Really well, it's a, it makes it, you know, you don't always love the things you're in, if you're really honest, but it's lovely. It's easy to sell stuff that you really have faith in. I think it's, I really love the film. Sort of film that I like to go and see anyway. It's sort of, you know, it's a psychological thriller adapted, as you say, from Daphne du Maurier's book, My Cousin Rachel.
A great story, though.
Great story, yeah. I mean, the book is like very thin. It's like a pamphlet, and adapted by Roger Michell, directed it, and
he did Notting Hill, of course.
He did, yeah, yeah.
So and different.
You know, it's so different, and actors love working with him. I mean, he's done lots at the National, done theatre. We've had sort of near misses a couple of times. I've always wanted to work with him, and then he, you know, this is the first time he said, you know, would you play this part? And I read the screenplay, I read the book, and I thought it was great, and was really happy to be on board. You know, I'd worked with Rachel Weisz about, oh God, 15, 20 years ago,
okay,
a comedy in Glasgow called Beautiful Creatures.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I played a psychotic heroin addict, and we had fun on that, so it was nice to cross paths.
Well, what I love about the direction, if you like, is there are some extreme close-ups, but
yes,
you really get the emotion. There's a servant there. I was talking to you before we came on air. There's a servant who manages, I don't know how he does it, but he has this dew drop hanging off his nose for the first three scenes, and it just lies there.
Brilliant.
It's just incredible.
First year at RADA. How do you keep it hanging there? How do you,
you spend a week on that sort of stuff. So the story is basically about Philip, who inherits his guardian's estate in Cornwall.
Right.
He then falls for his cousin Rachel, and that's when the trouble starts.
Yeah.
And, I mean, and you try and keep him on the straight and narrow, don't you?
I do. I mean, it's sort of about everyone's world being turned upside down by this gorgeous, exotic, beautiful creature who enters this sort of sleepy Cornwall community. And yes, the story is really about, is she benign or is she sinister? And throughout the entire movie, it never, that never really gets resolved.
No.
And that was du Maurier's intention. And so I think, and that's part of the extreme close-up, is all the time you're just looking for clues all the time. Is this for real? Isn't it for real? Why are they behaving this way? Rachel is stunning in it. I mean, she's so gorgeous, and you have to carry the audience with you all the time. As an audience member, I think you think, oh, you know, I've sort of fallen in love with her now.
I'm not sure.
I completely distrust her. And so, and Sam is great. It's a very different sort of role for him. And he's brilliant in it as well. The story lies there in their relationship. And I play a kind of, I don't know, it's like almost like a Greek chorus. I follow the audience's take on it and want what's best for him. I've been his legal guardian, and in his passion and his adoration of this girl, he wants to give everything over to her. So he wants to, his entire estate, all his money, all the jewelry, give. It's just all gone, you know. Just
you say that a lot.
No, yes, sir, I do. I do say that a lot.
We've got a clip, actually. Let's have a look.
Okay.
Have you been a little asking around? Did you know that the duel in which her first husband died was fought over one of her lovers?
Well, I don't believe that.
They were notorious, both him and her, for unbridled extravagance and apparently limitless appetite. Do you understand? Do you?
Where did you film it?
We were sort of, it was various locations around London. The primary one was, you remember Bamber Gascoigne?
Yeah.
And it was an estate I think he inherited and has found it difficult to kind of support. It's massive. And so they were very happy to have us, and it fitted our story because it's slightly gone to seed a little bit, and he was present, a sweet man. So, yeah, it was primarily there, different locations.
What, he was checking that you didn't steal anything?
Exactly,
asking
us quiz questions and stuff. But, and then in around Cornwall, different places.
Gosh.
But yeah.
I didn't like books. I didn't like cities. I didn't like clever talk. I liked it. Here.
The house, Penhale, where Ambrose and Philip live and where Rachel comes, is the other character in My Cousin Rachel. The house has to be a house that's kind of the centre of a farm rather than a mansion or a stately home.
West Horsley is a pretty extraordinary place. We were the first
full-on feature film in there, and we all really rather fell in love with the place.
Such a charming house. And your cousin has been giving me the grand tour.
It's a house that hasn't been as yet over-restored, so it's still real.
So much of it is original, it feels like it's not been touched for years. Beautiful and slightly dishevelled and has its own character, has so much history, you can feel it.
Bamber Gascoigne inherited this slightly unwillingly from a great aunt.
It was very surprising and I behaved very properly as well. I went in the solicitor's office, didn't look too amazed, kept my cool.
He's heroically decided to try and keep the spirit of the place alive.
It's a magnificent Tudor house. I mean, superb, amazing, great timber structures. In about 1640, the man who owned it commissioned this wonderful brick facade, which it now has, which is its greatest charm.
There is no bitter feeling in this house. Do you belong here now?
It's Grade 1 listed, which means that it's of the highest historical significance and importance and protected. But we were really able to take possession of it, to treat it as a kind of ancient standing set.
We had so much freedom, and that was a huge, huge plus for us. We pretty much made everything, all the curtains, brought all the furniture in, the fireplace downstairs. To be able to do that much work is quite rare.
Where are you going to put her?
She can have the blue room. She'd suit her perfectly.
The blue room is the room which has been laying dormant in the house that he proposes to put his cousin Rachel in when she arrives.
The best bedroom in the house, which was my aunt's mother, which here has always been called Lady Crewe's bedroom, I gather now it's just called Rachel's bedroom. And I think it's very likely that actually that will stick.
Making a period movie, especially one like this that has got gothic elements and stylized elements, this house has suited us perfectly.
It's exceptional to find somewhere like that. It really is like gold dust.
It's been amazing to have one location for the whole house. It became the home of the film.
Everyone involved in film knows about Du Maurier.
Daphne Du Maurier writes books that have a very tightly coiled plot. Her sense of suspense and sexual intrigue lends itself well to films.
There's an uneasiness beneath the surface in my cousin Rachel all the way through.
You know all about me. Of course.
I find her sort of way of writing very poetic and very kind of lyrical.
There's great passion in the story, there's great unpredictability and suspense in it.
The idea of relationship thrillers, I think, is very unique to her. There's not very many authors that tell such kind of extreme tales so subtly.
Her stories are incredibly dark. Jealousy, deception, the motives of people, these themes are always relevant.
It's a very dark, almost gothic tale of, is she poisoning him? Is he going insane? The essence of these essential questions is all based in any reality of early relationships. Getting to know someone, what do they mean? It's just heightened.
There's only one issue, and that's whether you want to stay or not.
How could you ask me that? You know the answer to that.
No, I don't.
It has got this kind of modern streak to it, about a woman who's self-defining and transgressive. She's just got her own personal ideas about the way in which a woman should be allowed to live.
I don't feel safe with you.
Du Maurier really does tap into the discomforts of how the mind and the emotion work in human beings and into their fears.
It's such a gripping read. By the time I got to sort of the middle of the book, I thought I just would love to make a film out of this.
Look, she has done for me at last. For God's sake, come quickly.
I have written to you several times. For weeks I've been ill. She watches me like a hawk. And there is no one I can trust to take my letters to the mail.
The key to the whole film is the ambiguity. You're on the edge of your seat trying to figure out, is she or isn't she? Did she or didn't she?
She's in England. She's here.
Rachel has been living in Italy for many, many years and married to Philip's cousin. He gets sick and dies.
The way that Philip approaches her initially is that she is a murderer.
Surely you don't believe all this nonsense about the tumour?
What possible motive could she have with nothing to gain from his death?
This suspicion, is she a force of good or is she looking after her own interests, is held in abeyance throughout the entire story.
How easy it must be for your cousin Rachel to twist you around her little finger.
You enter into a kind of emotional roller coaster, trying to puzzle out, did she kill Ambrose or didn't she? Is she trying to kill Philip?
The whole process of watching the film will be to try and figure out who to trust and who not to trust.
I've been doing a little asking around.
Your cousin is
notorious for unbridled extravagance and a limitless appetite.
People will think different things of Rachel. The story's equally weighted both ways. It will divide people.
How long have you been lying to me?
I don't feel safe with you.
You're completely infatuated with your cousin. You could lose everything.
Rachel is the widow of Philip's cousin.
She must be extremely charming for Ambrose to have noticed her.
I've come to England after my husband's death to return his books and his clothes to Philip. He thinks I've poisoned and murdered his cousin.
You know perfectly well she drove him to his death.
She arrives and she's not at all what he expects. She's beautiful, she's bewitching, she's everything he's never seen before in a woman, and he is enraptured.
You know nothing about her.
Or is it you who know nothing?
His obsession with this astonishing, captivating, mysterious woman, what does that do to your head?
It's not your run-of-the-mill average love story, because it's a love story which has great mystery and intrigue in it. To me, it's about how do you really ever know anyone?
I was an orphan. Ambrose took me in.
Philip Ashley is a young man left to grow up under the wings of his cousin, Ambrose.
Where is he?
He's dead.
Where's the woman?
Rachel is the widow of said cousin. Philip suspects her of foul play.
Whatever it cost him, in pain and suffering, I will return upon the woman that caused it.
She turns up and she's different. And so, of course, he's slowly bewitched by her.
All I know is that I like it now you're here.
What do you do if you start to gamble on your addiction to this woman who you thought you hated?
You could lose everything.
I'm willing to take that risk.
They push each other to the edge. Love does make you do crazy things.
God!
I want justice for Ambrose.
Rachel!
We have a great team of people kind of behind this film. Ian Holiday and Rachel are the three names of an amazing cast. It's a very grown-up role for me and a very grown-up project. These are the right people to kind of guide me through that.
Sam just popped out as being incredibly persuasive. He's sensitive, he's smart, but he's also young, he's vigorous.
He still has boyishness about him, which I don't think you can really fake. Either you've got that or you haven't.
Sam has that ability to present as a kind of fully grown man, but he also still is capable of carrying around a kind of boyish naivety.
You have to sway quite dramatically in your opinions of detesting and then falling in love, and I think he's managing that incredibly well.
You're not the woman I hated.
I've grown up with Rachel on the big screen, and to eventually have the opportunity to work with her, she sort of embodies the characteristics of Rachel.
My character's bohemian, very sexually liberated, not content just to be owned by a man and just be a piece of property.
She's playing each moment in the film with conviction for the moment that it is. This moment she's charming, and this moment she's furious.
Can't you let me be a person in my own right who's making her way in the world as she wishes to?
Rachel Weisz has such charm and charisma about her and such an openness. You can't help but fall in love with Rachel Weisz, and you can't help but fall in love with Rachel.
She must be extremely charming for Ambrose to have noticed her.
I've known Ian for years and years, and I've always wanted to work with him. He and Holiday, who plays his daughter Louise, are a really important brick in the construction of the film.
Kendall's character really has to be somebody who is the kind of benign godfather, the counterbalance to Philip's impetuous, headstrong obsession.
Ian has a kindness and a gravitas, and I think that's important to bring to Kendall.
It's my third time of working with Holiday, and I'm excited for the world to kind of see her on a new level.
the frame just completely lights up whenever Holiday is in the middle of it. She has that amazing ability to be extremely beautiful and extremely kind of ordinary at the same time.
Roger as a director attracts people who are of high quality. It's a really great community of actors.
I had discussions with Roger really early on. We were talking about where to set this.
We went for 1840 because we wanted to have society in transition. It's the beginning of the real industrial revolution. And things were changing. Countryside was changing, fashion was changing.
It's before those vast crinoline skirts came in, but it's after Jane Austen.
The men at this stage, at the end of the 1830s, it's softer. Sam, as Philip, had this feeling of a young man connected to the earth. His big coat with all the permanent breaking down of riding a horse and lovely riding boots.
Things were getting a little less dandyish, a little more workmanlike, and clothes for women were becoming less based on something that was decorative and becoming more practical.
It needed to feel very primitive in the country world so that her arrival is something absolutely enormous.
She's here.
Well, no luggage.
Rachel's a widow, so I arrive in England with two dresses, and they're both black. She's in mourning.
In the 19th century, you know, if you were a widow, you wore black for sometimes the rest of your life, as Queen Victoria did. And so that was a challenge.
She has a dress that she rides in, and also doubles as a day dress, and then she has a taffeta dress. The taffeta is really very, very simple with the long point, which brings the emphasis on the waist. This has got lots of softness to it, so when she's on the horse, this follows the shape of the saddle.
And then there's one dress, which is not a mourning dress. She comes out of mourning right at the end of the film. We would sip the tisana. Ambrose would sit there for hours.
Roger wanted her to have depth to it, and it had to be part of her world. The colour is just tremendous.
As her new life is starting to begin, there's a day where she goes out riding and she's wearing this gorgeous blue dress.
A lot of this crew are old friends reuniting. That's a wonderful way to make a film because there's a lovely family atmosphere on set. If you have that atmosphere, then people do their best work, and Dinah and the team have designed and made some of the most beautiful costumes.